Okay, good afternoon. The Minister is going to talk about the details of our benefit reform package in a moment, but I'm going to start by giving you a broad overview of what we are doing and why. The first thing I want to say is that when Minister Bennett and I talk about the welfare system, we do so with a healthy amount of first-hand experience. When I was young, my father died, my mother relied on the widow's benefit until she could get back on her feet and into a job. The Minister was a young sole parent who received the domestic purposes benefit on and off for a number of years. As a result, both of us have a strong commitment to the safety net that welfare provides. We believe in a welfare system that supports people when they are most in need, that encourages them to get back to work, and occasionally gives them a kick in the pants when they are not taking responsibility for themselves, their families, and other taxpayers. Currently, there are around 345,000 working age people receiving a benefit. Some people on a benefit will realistically never be able to work, and the welfare system will continue to support them. But for most people, a benefit should only provide temporary support until they can return to work. In fact, there is little chance of a better future for beneficiaries and their children unless they do come off a benefit and work for an income. Long-term welfare dependency imprisons people in a life of limited income and limited choices. Many people on a benefit can't wait to take the step back into work, and we should applaud them for that action. Some are fearful of it, and others are downright resentful. But the world of work is always going to offer more possibilities than the limitations of welfare. There's another factor here too. People who receive a benefit are able to do so only because others are going to work every day, earning a wage and paying their taxes. In many cases, these are people who are themselves far from well off. So it's not fair on working New Zealanders to have people receiving benefits but not making every reasonable attempt to pick themselves up, find a job and stand on their own two feet. For these reasons, our benefit reforms are squarely focused on getting people back to work and as soon as possible. These reforms will seem very familiar to many of you because they are, with a few tweaks, what we campaigned on at the last election. Out of the whole package, there are five aspects I'd like to outline briefly. First, the government is going to introduce part-time work obligations for two new groups of beneficiaries. These are DPB recipients whose youngest child is age 6 or over, and people on a sickness benefit who have been assessed as being able to work part-time. These people will need to be available for part-time work of at least 15 hours a week and accept suitable job offers or be undertaking work-related training. Work and income will, however, have a good deal of flexibility about people's individual circumstances. And where people do not have the skills to get a job, we will work with them to help them gain the skills they need. Second, the government will introduce more graduated sanctions for people who don't comply with their work obligations. At the moment, case managers have only one real sanction, and that is to stop benefit payments altogether. The government is going to give case managers more flexibility and a better range of tools by introducing an immediate step of a 50% reduction in the person's benefit, followed by full suspension and then cancellation of the benefit. Where beneficiaries have children in their care, however, they will face a maximum sanction of half their benefit. The third part of the package I want to highlight is an increase in the amount that people on the DPB and invalids benefit can earn each week without affecting their benefit, from $80 rising to $100. This will happen together with some other adjustments to abatement thresholds. These changes will give beneficiaries an additional incentive to work a few hours a week, get into the work habit, gain some confidence, and start building those important work skills. Fourth, the government is going to change the rules around the unemployment benefit so it can only be granted for a 12-month period. People who are still looking for work a year after going on to the unemployment benefit will have to reapply for their benefit. As part of that process, they will have to complete a comprehensive work assessment to determine what steps they need to take to move into or towards work. These new rules will provide a strong signal that the unemployment benefit is a temporary support only for people who are actively seeking work. The last part of the package I want to mention is a system of more frequent reassessments for people on the sickness benefit. The first two medical certificates issued to a sickness beneficiary will now be for a maximum of only 4 weeks each. This will ensure more attention from the person's doctor and case manager during the all-important first 2 months of being on the benefit. People on a sickness benefit will also face a compulsory reassessment by their case manager after 12 months, and they will involve a referral to a designated doctor. It's important to note that the reforms we're announcing today are not focused on saving money in the short term, they're focused on improving outcomes for beneficiaries. Over the medium to longer term, however, these changes will help with the sustainability of the welfare system. For example, if we were to assist just 5% of sole parents with a youngest child aged over 6 into work, there would be savings of almost $200 million over the next 10 years. While these reforms will improve the benefit system, there's still more work to be done. The government remains concerned about the prospects of growing welfare rolls in the decades ahead, accompanied, of course, by an increasing welfare bill. I signalled in my statement to Parliament that we would be establishing a working group to advise us on ways to reduce long-term welfare dependency. That process is going along well, and we will soon be able to announce the membership and terms of reference for this group. Today, however, it's about the government's package of benefit reforms, and I'd like to hand over to Minister Bennett to talk through that in more detail with you.
Right, thank you. Thank you, Prime Minister. I'm just going to take 3 minutes to run through some points, and then I think I'm better off taking questions so that we can get to the hub of what you want to talk about. So why are we doing this? We are doing this because we truly, and I truly believe, New Zealanders are better off in work. Too many people have become trapped in a lifetime of welfare, existing from week to week on a minimal income, trying to juggle bills, the cost of food, clothing, and looking after families. I believe many New Zealanders are selling themselves short and struggling on a benefit when they could be earning a much better living and living a much better life. There is no question paid work is the route to independence, the only way to truly get ahead and stand on your own two feet. I also believe being in work provides a sense of self-worth and pride that being on a benefit really doesn't. It also provides children with an example to follow in their own lives that will see them better off too. But equally, it should always be there as a safety net. And as the Prime Minister has already said, we both personally experienced the welfare system. It was there when we needed it, and that is as it should be. But my concern is that too many people view welfare not as a last option, but as a way of life. Welfare should never be a lifestyle choice. So this package aims to shift some long-held perceptions, a shift from a mentality of entitlement to one of self-responsibility. So when we say we'll expect those on the unemployment benefit to reapply after a year, it is because this is a temporary benefit for those who are temporarily unable to find work. If someone genuinely can't find work in 12 months, they'll be able to demonstrate their job search when they reapply. If a real demonstrable effort has been made, their benefit will be reinstated. If not, well, I'm afraid the dream is over. It is worth remembering a sickness benefit is also a temporary form of assistance, and many on that benefit are able to work part-time and should be working towards full-time work. In fact, 9,000 sickness beneficiaries have been assessed as being able to work part-time. We will expect them to do what they can to support themselves. We want to focus on what people can do, not on what they can't. For single parents on the DPB, we believe that when the youngest child turns 6, there is an opportunity to transition back to work. There are 43,000 people in this category. Future-focused legislation makes it clear we expect those people to work at least 15 hours a week. quite frankly, we refuse to write them off as incapable of working when there are so many solo parents who work and bring up their children successfully without state support. Emergency hardship payments need to be just that. We're tightening the system up so that these payments go only to those in genuine need, to those whom life has simply thrown one too many curveballs. For those that attempt to milk the system will find themselves plain out of luck. Last year, the government paid out over $250 million in hardship payments, and that, frankly, is unsustainable. More will be done to ensure people are taking steps to manage their own finances. Self-responsibility is key. At the end of the day, taxpayers are funding beneficiaries. Now, New Zealanders have an innate sense of fairness. Most are happy to support those that really need it, but taxpayers should not have to fund lifestyle beneficiaries. It is unfair on those who work hard to provide for themselves and their families. It is only fair that those who can work do. Now I think we can take some questions.
You delayed a lot of these measures last year because you said the recession was too harsh and that simply weren't job opportunities out there. The unemployment is higher than it's ever been. What makes you think that if you're pushing people out to work, the jobs are there for them?
So we're this is a staged process, so this legislation will go before the House and it's then going to go through the Select Committee process. We're looking at introduction of most of these at the end of September. After September it will be measured groups that we'll be working with to get them on, so all 43,000 on the DPB, for example, will not be expected to be in work within the first week. After that, it'll be a staged process working with their case managers. But we also need to look at, like, for the month of February alone, we saw 5,000 come off the unemployment benefit and into jobs. So that's not including those students that went into study. 5,000 went into jobs. Over 1,000 on the DPB in the month of February alone went into work and off the benefit. So there is still work there, and we believe that it's a case of them actually sort of making that available, getting the right sort of training in place as well.
I think it's also worth remembering that both Treasury and Department of Labour estimate that if we're not at the top of unemployment, we're very close to it. So the expectations are that unemployment rates will be falling over the bulk of 2010 and certainly into 2011, 2012, the longer-term predictions are for lower levels of unemployment. So we'd expect to get back to more normalised rates of around about 5% in a few years. So those opportunities are going to be there.
From what you've said, seem to believe, obviously, that a number of people are brought in the system, as you put it, making a lifestyle choice. I mean, what do you have figures, analysis around how many on benefits at the moment are likely to be doing that?
Well, we can certainly see the figures of how many people are on long-term welfare dependency, and we also now know intergenerational welfare, where we see people whose own children are going onto it for many years as well. I mean, we saw an example of just a few weeks ago where someone on the unemployment benefit felt that they did not have an obligation to actually be looking for work and that it was his choice to actually be on the unemployment benefit. So we do see many examples of it, and we can look at those that are on long-term welfare dependency to get an indication of that.
So how many
For a year or more? Let me just double check that figure for you. Sorry. Yeah, it is. From memory, that it's something like. I'm sorry, I've just got so many figures in my head right now that I don't want to give you the wrong one. So don't.
When you're talking about lifetime dependency, what's the average duration of
people? Sorry, what was that?
I mean, you're framing this in the context of lifetime dependency. Can you tell me what, on average, is the duration of time that people spend on the DPB?
Yeah, well, there's lots of different figures, but most of them actually come off within 5 years. So for most of those on the DPB, it is a short-term measure. I suppose it's those that have been on for 10 years or more that start actually having the cost and that long-term welfare dependency that we see. But for this is those that have got children aged 6 or over that we're looking at a part-time work test for.
So what proportion of those on the DPB would you categorise as being a lifestyle choice that signals lifetime dependence or long-term dependency?
Well, I think that to put an actual percentage on it would be misleading. What you're looking at is those that have been on long-term welfare dependency for a long time and certainly are making no moves to get off and find it is their right to sort of be on forever and don't have an expectation that they will be work tested. But we equally see those that want to be on for a short period of time and want that assistance within training and getting further ahead so that they can move off.
What will be the requirement for part-time work? Because obviously a lot of part-time work for those people could be in hospitality trade, cleaning and the like, but often nighttime work, so that the expectation that they'll have to take that sort of work?
Yeah, it does have to be realistic, so it has to be the types of jobs that can fit in with their children and with those sorts of things. We're looking at the OSCA, the after-school care, to make sure that we're making some changes within that as well. So it would have to fit in with that person, that the job is realistic, that they can actually do it. So if someone had no childcare options, the only job that was available was shift work at night, then no, they wouldn't have to take that job and leave their child alone, obviously.
Is there benefit abated, notwithstanding the new limits that you've set here, is their benefit presumably is abated once they start that 15 hours work?
Yes, so at the moment, it's at $80 a week. It hasn't been actually put up since 1996, so we're raising that for those on the DPB from 80 to 100, and then we're also raising the second abatement level from 180 to $200 a week to give them that bit extra in their pocket. So yes, once they're earning over $80 or over $100 now, there will be an abatement.
What does work testing involve? I mean, so some of these people that will come in have been unemployed for many, many, many years, and they have all sorts of problems. You can hear drug, alcohol, low self-confidence. You may even describe them as unemployable in some senses. What happens to someone in that?
Yeah, well, we're looking at, so we already do a number of job support schemes. Some of them are internal via Work and Income, and some of them are outsourced to different organisations. Then there's a whole lot of training that's going on within the PTEs and via TOPS and everything else. So we see it as a long term. I mean, if you ask me what I see longer term, I see some of those parents whose youngest turns 3 and their child's in early childcare getting the 20 hours free actually in part-time work training so that they can then, by the time that child's settled in school, they can get into work and have built themselves up to that level of upskilling. So that's sort of where we see it, is it's not an overnight thing. For some, it's going to take them quite a while to gain that confidence and the skills they need. 50% of those on the DPB have no qualifications whatsoever from school or anywhere else. So we need to really be giving them that sort of help to actually get them to a skill level where they can get those jobs, and we're very aware of that.
The previous national government had about 3 attempts at toughening up on welfare benefit payments during the 90s. None of them made any difference to the number of people going on to benefits. I mean, it was only strong economic growth that then led to a decline. I mean, what difference will this make? I mean, without, you know, economic growth?
Well, it's part of a package of measures. I mean, fundamental economic growth is critical to the whole equation. If there aren't jobs there, then people can't go to them. So we're a government that's very focused on economic growth. But we're also focused on sending the right message, and that is that this is about mutual obligation. We as the state have a responsibility to provide support for people who really need it, but you as the individual recipient also have an obligation back to your fellow taxpayers that you'll do everything you possibly can to get a job. And I think that you have to ask yourself, what's the counterfactual? If we don't get to step up and tackle the difficult issues where people either won't get a job when they can or won't get the skills when they can, the answer is they will languish on a benefit for the rest of their adult life. And I think that's unacceptable to most New Zealanders.
And these look quite different, if I just might add, to the 1990s, and when we're not doing a full-time work test. Now you've got in-work tax credits and other things that make it far more beneficial. We're raising the abatement rates. There's that real incentive stuff there as well to help people into work, which looks quite different than it did 10 years ago.
What analysis have you got? I mean, presumably you must have an idea of numbers of people who otherwise would just languish without these sorts of changes.
Yeah, we've certainly looked at how many we think that these incentives and obligations will make a difference to, and you can see some of those in the numbers that you've got, that you look at even if you just moved 5% off, then you're making a big difference. But with 43,000, we're looking at working with sort of 4,500 at any one time. I mean, we'll start with those that have got qualifications that have more recently been in work and move them off, but a lot of it does depend on the economy and the jobs that are there. I mean, quite frankly, if there's not a job there for you to go in, to, then you will not be losing your benefit.
How many people do you expect to come off the unemployment benefit as a result of this?
Well, we're already seeing those numbers moving quite a lot. I think what the difference this is going to make is for those that are on for a year or more. I mean, I actually think we work quite well with those that are coming in for temporary assistance. We back that up with the right sort of training. We keep in contact with them. There are some that fall through the cracks. This will be picking them up. So for the unemployment benefit, I think that some of it we will see them move off relatively quickly because it will give them a bit of a fright that they're actually going to be looked at more closely.
But do you have projections for the numbers you expect?
Well, because it's changing month to month, just with the changing economy and the jobs that are there for them, to actually be putting another percentage on top of that starts getting a bit more interesting. But, you know, we certainly have projections and we think that those on the unemployment benefit will come off with a lot a year or more.
Do you have the same criteria for whether someone can work or not as ACC will? How will it measure?
Yeah, we have looked closely at the ACC, and we're also looking closely at how they do, particularly with the sickness benefit and the similarities with them. But that's something that we want the Work and Welfare Working Group to look at a bit more closely, is that sort of movements within sickness, that interface between ACC and sickness beneficiaries, that rehabilitation side of how we are actually getting people well, you know, where that sort of assistance comes from. So what we're doing with the invalids benefit is when we looked at that really closely, because it is an area of concern, certainly when you've got 85,000 people and they are more likely to be on a benefit for longer, then it starts getting, you know, we start needing to really looking at that. What we looked at, though, was that we want the Welfare Working Group to look at that more closely, that long-term welfare dependency, but we're going to have a stricter criteria for those that are going on it. So at the moment, some of the sort of low-level mental illnesses, some of those people sort of go on the invalids benefit. They're then not actually worked with as to what they can do. A much more focus on what they can do instead of what they can't. Some of the doctors sort of call it a fitness test, if you like. Let's actually see what is possible for you. And so we're just looking at tightening up that criteria of what is on the invalid's benefit without actually needing to change it.
Will that 13-week reassessment for sickness beneficiaries remain? So it's not clear, you're saying that there'll be the 4 weeks in the...
There's a 4-week, 8-week and a 12-week, I think it is, from memory. Yes,
it
will.
It says in here that every 13 weeks they have to go back. Will that continue or will that be superseded by the yearly review?
Yes, it will continue.
And what will that yearly review be?
The yearly review will make sure that, because really the way I look at the sickness benefit, it is you are temporarily unable to work, and it's those that are on for a year or more that it starts getting more difficult. So at the year point, we will be doing a full assessment with them, checking that they're on the right benefit, checking that they are making the right sort of moves to get well, a closer relationship with doctors, and we've been having quite a lot of conversations with the GPs about what that medical certificate looks like. If there's any level of unease, then they can be sent to a designated doctor at that 12-month period to make sure that actually we are working, you know, they're on the right benefit and actually they are there correctly, if you like.
So what happens if you're on the unemployment benefit? If you can't cut after a year, you can't, you know, haven't made the right steps to get a job, what happens
then? Yeah. So there's two sort of things. So one is the reapplying after a year, and that to have that continue, you just need to be able to prove, and quite frankly, most will be able to do it quite easily, that they have been looking for work, that they are attending interviews as they come up, and they are more than available to take a job if it's the right one. The other thing is the sanction process, which is a little bit different, which really says that you send someone on an interview and they do not attend that interview. You know, at the moment, there's a real process to go through to actually look at sanctioning someone's benefit, and as the Prime Minister indicated, it's so blunt that actually case managers are reluctant to use it and it sort of gets difficult. Everything we looked at as far as the best evidence says that if it's clean, it's simple and it's actually a bit more graduated, people know exactly where they stand and what's expected of them, and case managers are more likely to use it. So in some respects for sanctions, they're going to be just 50% first and then 100%, but I do expect them to be used more.
So as long as they're responding to interviews that might be arranged by the case manager,
and looking themselves. I mean, most people actually find a job on their own means by looking through and they also turn up for job support each week at Work and Income. It's quite easy for them to actually show that they are looking for work and meeting their obligations. So as long as they are meeting their obligations, then their benefits will not be cut.
Yeah, 'cause I just think, I mean, isn't there evidence, though, the longer people are unemployed, the more they get depressed about the situation and find it harder and harder to have the motivation to go out and look themselves because they constantly get rejected. I mean, where do you sort of draw the line around that?
Yeah. What we've done, though, in the last year is there's been a lot more emphasis on the sort of right sort of confidence building, motivation, getting the people to apply for the right jobs. So it used to be that people sort of sent out, you know, sort of CVs to jobs that they perhaps were not suitable for and were never going to get them, and instead got more rejections that actually affected their motivation. So there's a lot closer case management. There's, you know, there's job support schemes that actually run from work and income that people turn up that are giving real advice to people on how and what is the best way to find work. And that seems to be working, but you know, we're quite aware that a lot of it's around that confidence and motivation, so getting the right sort of incentives and then asking them to step up to their obligations as well.
You know, there's some costings around this. What are some of the costings?
Yeah, certainly.
Well, Treasury estimates are very, very conservative, but essentially $100 million and then moving out to $200 million worth of savings, so about $300 million in total over a 4 to 10 year period. But we would our view is that Treasury is being extremely conservative.
Because that implies hardly any change at all, $100 million on a $4.8.
Well, I think there's two things. I mean, there would be anticipated significant growth over time without us making these moves. So that's one thing. Because if you go back and have a look at, you can argue the case over the last decade, there was reasonably strong employment growth in New Zealand, but those on benefits, if you look in totality, were rising. Significant increase in sickness and invalids benefits. So this is firstly going to try and control the growth on that 345,000 number. But our view is actually there are substantial savings over time. But the main driving focus here is to get people back into work, to build their work skills, to build their self-esteem. It's not just about fiscal savings.
How many of these 345,000 on the benefit are Māori?
Depends by benefit, actually.
Yeah, so it does. It depends by which benefit you mean. So, I mean, at the moment, we're looking at the unemployment benefit. The numbers there are about, of the young people, are about 15% and more.
30%.
Sorry, what was that?
We have some figures between 15 and 19-year-olds, about 37%.
Yeah, and what we're seeing though is for the month of February, more than half of those that did go off the benefit were young people as well. So, and they were moving into work, predominantly 80% of them moving into work and not just going into training. So, you know, we have hope the job ops scheme is making a difference for them, but there's a lot of work yet to be done.
Does this involve more intensive casework, and if so, do you have to start?
So what we've done is in the last year made a real effort at working at, because if you ask me what will really make a difference, it is that case management, it's that relationship there, it's identifying that everyone's different and are individuals, and some need confidence building, some just need to steer in the right direction, some need to actually go on courses. So for example, we introduced the payment card, which just means that we're not filling in a whole lot of forms and we've cut the administration down there. Over a 3 month period, we saved 11,700 case manager hours just because of the breakdown in administration that's required there. We've really looked at what we can do as far as streamlining the system. For the extra staff that we were given last year because of the increase in numbers, we've turned around and introduced the job support whole call centre place where so people are getting more help via the telephone for those that actually need a short term. We introduced a whole scheme for those sort of, we estimated about 24% actually need very minimal help from work and income, and in fact didn't want to be slowing them down from finding a job. So we simplified the system that they can get the bit of assistance they need, but they're more likely to find a job if we just leave them alone and let them get on with it within that first 12-week period. So we've really been looking at that whole sort of system and how it works. We've got what we call the Lean Six Sigma. We've introduced that into work and income offices. It's making a huge difference in our effectiveness and our efficiencies so that we can then spend the time working with individuals.
So your answer is yes, you've got enough staff.
Yes, we do have enough staff now.
Enough
train. Yeah, very much so. And I mean, particularly with the DPB, when you go around the work and income offices, you meet predominantly women who have actually been on the DPB themselves, who are really passionate about helping those women into work. And they do an outstanding job. I've got people putting their hands up and saying, we just want to be the champion for this. It'll give us the right sort of levers, and we believe that we can move more into work.
What's the estimate of the costs during this first year of the new regime with sickness beneficiaries? Are the costs to the sickness beneficiary of the 58,000 who will now have to comply with the new regime.
So that's just that second for that extra doctor's visit, and we've looked at that closely. But from the GPs and from people themselves, what we hear is that it's actually quite likely that they would visit a doctor three times in the first 3 months if they're that unwell that they're having to be on a sickness benefit. So actually, for most of them, we don't believe it will be an extra visit that they have to do. They're probably doing it anyway. We're just making it more of a requirement. If they have to go to a designated doctor, then we will pay for that. But for that extra visit within that first 12 months, and they will be picking up that cost themselves. But certainly the evidence we've seen says that most people on a sickness benefit, as I say, should be visiting their doctor within that first 12 weeks, three times anyway.
Because you've got 9,000 people who are assessed, who are on this benefit, assessed as being capable of part-time work or light duties, but you've got 58,000 people in that category. Why are you imposing this burden on the remaining 49,000?
No, so they're quite different things. So one is making sure that people are on the right benefit, that they are getting the sort of assistance that they need, that they're seeing their doctors and we're moving them off. The other is the 9,000 people that currently a doctor sits down and when he fills out their form, he ticks the box that says, I believe these people could be working part-time. So we're not putting extra obligations on those other ones that are not part of the 9,000 at all. They're actually two quite separate policy.
Okay, so maybe we'll leave you to digest it. Questions, if you've got any more questions, we'll come back. Thanks very much.